Greetings again today in that name that's far above every name, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Appreciate you being here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. May the good Lord bless you and warm your hearts. And you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. I'm hoping during the hour coming up we can be an inspiration. Turn, will you please, to Isaiah chapter 5. Isaiah chapter 5 and then Luke chapter 13. I'm speaking today on this subject, three disappointing years. Three disappointing years, tape number 311. Now, tune in and get our broadcast each day at 12 o'clock noon. And then I want to say just this word to you that I've sent brochures to pertaining to our proposed Holy Land tour for March of next year. We have changed our agencies. We now have a tour set up for lesser than $1,200 from New York across and back to New York, 11-day tour. Be going to Jordan, be going to Petra, the Red Rose in Petra, and be going to Masada and in the land of Israel, and it's lesser than $1,200, whereas the other would cost around $1,700 or more. And some of you that received the brochure and maybe thought the price was a little high, you might be interested in this. If so, you need to get in touch with me in the next few days. In the next week or so, if you're interested, if the price was too high on the other brochure, and this is one of the greatest, I mean, price-wise, that we've had to offer. And it's a trip from New York back to New York for less than $1,200, 11 days. That covers your ticket over there and back. It covers your motel, hotel rooms. It covers your meals over there. And it's a real trip of a lifetime. Now give it a thought. If you're interested, get in touch with me right away. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. Let me hear from you. And remember, this broadcast is a faith broadcast, and don't forget us at this time of the year, because it's not always easy to maintain a faith ministry at this particular time of the year. So don't let God's work down. Pray for me and write to me, and we appreciate it very much. Isaiah chapter 5. Now will I sing to my well-beloved a song of my beloved touching his vineyard. My well-beloved hath a vineyard in a very fruitful hill. And he fenced it and gathered out the stones thereof and planted it with the choicest vine and built a tower in the midst of it, and also made a wine press therein, and it looked that it should bring forth grapes, and it brought forth wild grapes. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem, and men of Judah, judge, I pray you, betwixt me and my vineyard. What could have been done more to my vineyard that I have not done in it? Wherefore, when I looked that it should bring forth grapes, it brought forth wild grapes. Now go to, I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will take away the heads thereof, and it shall be eaten up, and break down the wall thereof, and it shall be trodden down. I will lay it waste, it shall be not be pruned, nor digged, but there shall come up briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that the rain, that no rain upon it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the host of Israel, and the men of Judah is his pleasant plant. And he looked for judgment, but hold oppression, for righteousness, and behold a cry. That's reading from Isaiah chapter 5, verses 1 through 7. Now turn over to the book of Luke chapter 13, page 1094 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. I still have three Scofield Reference Bibles left after the Christmas season thus far. I only have three left if you're interested. Now in Luke chapter 13, beginning with verse 6, and he spake also this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came and sought fruit thereon, and found none. Then said he unto the dresser of his vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree and found none. Cut it down, why cometh it to ground? And he answered and said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also, till I shall dig about it and dung it. And if it bear fruit, well, and if not, then after that thou shalt cut it down. Now notice verse 7. The man said for 3 years he came looking for fruit on the tree, and he found none. He had 3 disappointed years. I want to speak to you about that today. Now, this is primarily to Israel, no doubt about that. And God took them out of barren Egypt, planted them in fertile Canaan. Christ sought for fruit from them for 3 years and found none. And then Israel was scattered and cut off, according to Romans chapter 11 and verse 20. Those 3 years Jesus walked upon the earth, he found no fruit among Israel, not producing the good, the fig tree barren. Now I want us to apply that today to our own hearts and lives in this day in which we live in the service of God. Notice number 1, this tree was chosen and planted in a vineyard. It didn't just happen up. It was a special tree and was planted in a special vineyard, in a fertile soil. It was planted in a place where it should produce figs, but it did not. Verse 6, he spake also this parable, a certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard. It came and sought fruit thereon and found none. So this was a special tree. A man took great interest in this and planted in his vineyard. Now you, as a child of God, you have been planted. Now you shouldn't take your position lightly. You shouldn't take your standing before God lightly. You have been planted in the body of Christ. You have been planted in the vineyard of God. You have been planted where you can serve God. God has planted you here, some of you at Northside. God planted you here where you can serve Him. God planted you in the vineyard. And you need to serve God faithfully because you were chosen and you were planted. Maybe you just didn't happen up and maybe joined the Northside Baptist Church just in a kind of a careless manner just to be doing something. If you did, then it wasn't real. But you came here and God planted you here and God laid on your heart to become part of the tree in this vineyard that you may serve God. You were chosen of God, planted, supplied, and protected in God. You need to realize that. That moves us to thought number 2, and that is it was owned by a certain man. And I'm dealing with scripture here from Luke chapter 13. You need to look at it. Verses 6 through 9, as I expatiate upon these verses, because they're impregnated with truth you need to see here today. It was owned by a certain man. The Bible said a man owned this fig tree. A man owned this vineyard. It wasn't out there owned by the government. It wasn't out there maybe a barren land that nobody cared anything about or wasn't owned by anyone. It was owned by someone. Now today, as you sit here in this auditorium, and as you listen out in the radio listening audience, you're owned by someone. The Bible says you're not your own, you're bought with a price. Let me give you the scripture. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 19 and 20. What, know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost which is in you, which you have of God, and you're not your own, for you're bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and your spirit, which is God. So you're not sitting out there saying, well, I own myself. I own my wife. My wife owns me, or my family owns me, or Uncle Sam owns me. No, no. If you're a child of God, you're owned by the Lord. You belong to God. You're not your own. You can't go out here and live the kind of life, maybe a worldly type kind of life, careless and unconcerned, and don't care attitude about God and the work of God. If you do, you're disobedient. You're owned by the Lord. You're not your own. You can't always do what you want to do. You need to do what God wants you to do. Some of you on Wednesday night sit at home, look at TV and say, well, it's Wednesday night, a little prayer meeting, small crowd, and I'm a little tired anyway. I'll just sit at home because I'm a man of my own, do what I want to. Don't kid yourself. You belong to God. You become disobedient when you take that attitude. You need to find your place in the house of God where God is doing business, where you belong, where you should be on the Lord's day and when services are going on. You're owned by God. You're not your own. You can't do what you want to do all the time. You must do what you know is right and what you believe is right, what you should do as a child of God. You know you should do it, then do it. You belong to God. You're not your own. Don't be too independent and think, well, I do what I want to and nobody's business. I belong to myself. I'm 21 or over and I'll do what I want to do. Don't forget there's a God in heaven that you belong to. You can't always do what you want to do. I can't always do what I'd want to do flesh-wise or worldly-wise. I must do what God wants me to do. So it's owned by a certain man. So today you have been bought by the blood of Jesus and you're owned by God. You don't belong to yourself anymore. When God saved you, that means you're His. You belong to Him. You can't go out and say, well, I'll live the kind of life I want to live. No, no. You belong to God. You'll give an account unto God for it if you try to do it. Number three, it was planted to bring forth fruit. Now this man, when he went out and planted that fig tree, he said, one of these days I'm going to have some nice figs on this tree. He picked out a real nice one and he found a real fertile place there in his vineyard. And he dug a nice hole and put nice dirt around that fig tree. He said, well, it won't be long until I will have some figs. And when time came for him to get the figs, he was disappointed. It was planted to bring forth fruit. Look at verse 6. And a certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came and sought fruit thereon. So he said, now is the time of the year that I can go down to my vineyard and gather me some a nice basket full of fruit. Good old juicy figs, and they grow big and juicy in Israel. And he said, I'll just go down and get me some nice figs, and I appreciate my old fig tree down there. I know it ought to be really producing by now. And when he comes down to check on his fig tree, lo and behold, there's not a fig on it. Oh, how disappointed. Oh, he said, I found the best tree. I put it in the best soil. I put a fence around my vineyard. I protected that fig tree that no animal could come in and harm it. Nobody could bother it. I fertilized it. I had the tree well set in a nice place for sunshine and rain. And now I come to get me some figs, and they're not there. They're not there. He planted that fig tree to bring forth fruit. God didn't save you to sit on the stool of do-nothing saying, I shall not be moved. No, sir. God didn't save us to sit around and do nothing, twiddle our thumbs. God saved us for a purpose. In verse 6, he planted it in the vineyard and sought fruit thereon. In John chapter 15, verse 8, herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, so shall my Father be glorified. So here, God is glorified when we produce the goods. When we bring forth the fruit, that's what he saved us for, to glorify him. That's the way God is glorified. Our Father is glorified when I produce fruit. Now, your primary duty is to glorify God. You're to glorify God in every way possible that you possibly can. Glorify God. That you should do. God expects you to do that. And if we don't do it, that's a disappointment. Now, notice thought number 4, and that's this one. The owner came to seek to check the tree for fruit, verse 6. He came and sought fruit thereupon. God has a perfect right to check your life, to check you out every day, to check you out every night, to see what you're doing for Him. God has a perfect right to do so, and He does. God checks you every morning. God checks you every night. God checks your life every day. God checks your life every night. He has a perfect right to do so because we belong to Him. When you own something that's valuable, you don't cast it aside and say, well, I don't think I'll bother about looking at it or checking on it anymore. I'll just let her go. No, no. If you own something that's valuable, then you're going to check on that. I mean, you're going to take a look at it. I remember many years ago, I was in a revival meeting in Roanoke, Virginia. And there the pastor was building a new church auditorium. And they worked on it every day. That man rode by that church every time he left his house and every time he came back to his house. Now, sometimes he had to go all the way to do it. But if he went to the grocery store, he rode by that church to see what's going on. He was so proud of it. And when he came back from the grocery store, he rode by it again. When he went to the post office, he rode by it. He came back by that church. Every day he went by that church several times. What was he doing? He was checking on it. He was proud of that work there. He was proud of what God was doing. And he was the pastor of that flock. He had a perfect right to check and see what was going on. And he did. Now God checks our lives every day and every night. He has a right to expect something from us. You think God would save us and pay the price he did for us and put us in the body of Christ and go to heaven and be preparing a place for us up there and then not expect something out of you? God's expecting something out of you, and he wants you to do it willingly because you love him. He wants you to do it because you belong to him and you want to do it for him. I don't like when people do things for me against their will. Somebody says, well, Preacher Edwards, it's time of the year for me to give you something. I hate to do it, but since it's that time of the year, birthday, Christmas, whatnot, I'm going to give. No, they can keep it as far as I'm concerned. I don't want it like that. If somebody can't do something to me because they want to and because they love me and because they should do it, I don't want it. Just keep it. I don't want it. I wouldn't have it if I knew that. I'd give it back to you. No, sir. I don't want it under that circumstance. You must remember, he has a right to check our lives. He has a right to expect fruit from us. And he is disappointed when he finds it not. Disappointed. Three years of disappointment. This man came, checked his fig tree, and found no fruit. That moves us to thought number 5, and that is the master's complaint. Notice verse 7, the master's complaint. Then said he under the dress of his vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree and find none. Cut it down, why cometh it to ground? Now he said to the man attended the vineyard, he said, now I got a complaint I want to make. I've come here for 3 years. Every year I came to get a basket of fruit, and I haven't found the first fig. I'm sick and tired of coming here disappointed, finding no fruit. The old tree's producing nothing. I'm tired of it. I've been long suffering for 3 years. I've waited, and here you see his wearied patience falling away. And he said, now, I'll tell you what, a vineyard keeper, I want you to take a sharp axe and I want you to lay her down. I want you to cut that stinking fig tree down. I bought that thing. I had the best fig tree I could buy. I brought it and put it in the best soil that I could find. I have a nice fence around this vineyard. I protected this tree. I cared for it. I set it where the sun could shine on it and where the rain could hit it. And I come here now 3 years in succession, and I haven't found the first fig. Chop it down. Take your axe and lay her down. I don't want to come here anymore and be disappointed. I'm sick and tired of this unbarren fig tree. Cut her down. There you have the master's complaint. Beloved, listen to me. God has a perfect right to complain if we let him down. When God saved us by his precious blood and we let God down, he has a right to complain. We let God down on the Lord's Day. If we want to do something else, we do it. Goodbye, Jesus. Goodbye, house of God. Goodbye, I'll see you later. If I need you, all right. If I don't, I'll see you sometime later. Doing revivals on Wednesday nights. Well, Lord, you know how it is. Yes, he knows how it is. You're too sorry and lazy and too involved in the world and the TV set and programs and the things you want to do to be found in the house of God. God knows that. You don't fool God. Oh, listen, God has a right to complain. God has a perfect right to complain about your carelessness and unconcernedness about the things of God. You need to know, he said, cut her down. Cut it down. And I'm going to drop a bombshell right here. Are you listening? There's people today that God spoke to and they wouldn't serve God. And God kept expecting fruit of them. They didn't serve God. And God cut them down. You know where they are? Cemetery. In the cemetery. They weren't going to serve God. God got tired of fooling with them and just moved them off the racetrack, get them out of the way. And he said, cut her down. Cut her down. I know some preachers today. They decided they would quit preaching and they were really called of God. I mean, anointed of the Holy Ghost, called of God, and decided they'd quit. You know where they are today? In the graveyard. You know where they could be had they obeyed God? Preaching the gospel. I know we have a lot of men in the ministry today God never called. 9 men out of 10 that fill our pulpits today have never been called of God. You have about 1 out of 10 preachers in the United States of America that's been called of God. 50% of the priests, I read the other day, 50% of the priests in the Catholic Church are homosexuals. Beloved, there's a lot of them in the Baptist movement, a lot of them in the Protestant movements today. Not called of God. They are in the ministry, but they're not called of God. 1 out of every 10 are called of God to preach the gospel. And if that one decides he will do what he wants to do, you know what God will do with him? Put him 6 foot under. God will place him in the cemetery and get him out of the way. Now he said, number 6, the solemn question, why cometh it to ground? Verse 7, why cometh it to ground? Why should this tree sit here and suck from the ground and use up fertilizer and so forth that the other vineyard, the other plants could be using, and just year after year, there is sucking from the ground and doing nothing? I'm tired of it, he said. I don't want it done. If it can't produce the goods, I'll move her off the scene. Take your axe, chop her down. Why let it stand here? Why let it drain the ground? Why let it hinder the others? It was hindering others. It was using fertilizer and moisture that the others could have been using. Why let it stand when another could be put in its place? Why let that fig tree stand there when I could just cut her down, put another one there? One will do the job. I'm standing today preaching because I had an uncle that God called to preach. He's greatly instrumental in winning me to God. Had personality plus. Oh man, he was a wizard when it come to personality. And he could have been used of God. God saved him. God called him to preach. He backslid on God. God cut him down and planted me in his place. Now, some of you don't understand that, but I do. I know what I'm talking about. It's a long story, and I know that as much as I'm standing behind this desk today. God cut him down. He didn't produce the fruit, and God moved him off the scene, and I stopped him from being a hindrance and got him out of the way. And you need to realize that God can do that. Why let him stand here? Let's put another in his place, and now why let him be a pretender? Well, that tree is just pretending. People come by and say, oh, what a beautiful fig tree. I know that owner appreciates that tree. Well, that thing was a number one hypocrite. That thing was a pretender. It was standing there straight as an arrow, looking as beautiful as could be, and didn't produce not the first fig. Oh, don't be a pretender. Don't be a pretender. Be what you are. God knows what you are anyway. All right, let's move to thought number 7. And this address is in a session. In verse 8 and 9, the man that attended the garden, he wanted to keep that tree. He hated to cut it down. And in verses 8 and 9, and he answered and said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also, till I dig about it and dung it, and if it bear fruit, well, if not, then after that thou shalt cut it down. Now here this man pleads for more grace. Oh, he said, Mr. Owner, just let me give it one more chance. I'll tell you what, I'm going to dig around it. And I'm going to get some of the best fertilizer I can find, and I'm going to put around this tree. And sir, I'm going to do everything I can for it to produce the fruit. And then, sir, we'll give it one more year. And if it doesn't do the job, then down she's going. Now, when Jesus came, for 3 years, he found no fruit. Through the grace of God, Jesus let his apostles preach the gospel for, you might say, another year. And then Israel still didn't produce the goods. God said, whack them down. And God cut Israel down and scattered her the four corners of the earth after the disciples and apostles preached around for about a year, and they didn't do the job. Beloved, listen, God expects us to be blessed and used of him. And God's grace is extended toward us. And did you know Jesus, our advocate, our attorney in heaven, pleads with God the Father to be patient with us and give us another chance? Did you know that? He certainly does. He pleads for grace. And he said this year also, in John chapter 17, verse 15, I pray not that thou should take them out of the world, Jesus said, that thou should keep them from the evil. Jesus said, Father, I'm not praying you take them out of the world. Keep them evil. Give them another chance. And our great intercessor, our great attorney, our advocate, at the right hand of God the Father, pleads with God for us. He says, give North Side another chance. Give each member another chance to do something. And we have that year coming up, 1988. What are we going to do about it? Are we going to do it? God's given us another chance. Get something done. We need to take that individually. And of course, as a group anyway, as a body also, but individually. Next year, we have a chance. We got a chance to be faithful. We got a chance to serve God. We got a chance to do something. Got a chance to try to win our lost loved ones. Got a chance to try to win our friends to God. God's going to give us another chance. And are we going to take the advantage of it? Or is God going to cut us down? Now, he pleads for more grace. Now, there's many a church member still in the vineyard, the place of fruit barren, but bears none. Just as unconcerned about the things of God as a lost sinner out here. Just as unconcerned about Bible study and prayer and Christian giving as a lost sinner out here. Just as unconcerned about the service in this church as a lost sinner out there. You think God's pleased with that? God's got your number. One of these days, he's going to knock on your door. God knows your number. He's going to call you up. God's going to pay you a visit, as certain as the world. Now, this could be our last year. We don't know when Jesus is coming. We don't know when we're going out individually. We don't know what year the number 19, we don't know whose number will be on what number of the year will be on our grave marker. It might be 1987, the years that will be it. It might be 1988. People may go by and say, so-and-so, born so-and-so, died 1988, so-and-so. Will 1988 be my grave marker? Will it be on your tombstone? It's going to be on somebody's. You need to think about these things. God can give us another year. And so this man said that I'm going to promise more work. Verse 8, I'll dig about it, I'll dung it. Now, is God digging about your life? Let me ask you a question. Is God digging around your life? Now, let me explain what I'm trying to say. Is God stirring you up? Is God allowing things to really happen that you might be a better Christian? That's what I'm trying to say. If so, what God is doing, he's digging around you, and he's fertilizing you, and he's making you a better tree to produce the fruit. And it hurts sometimes when God starts digging. And it really bothers sometimes when God begins to plow around us and when God begins to fertilize. And he agreed. He said, now after I do that, after I dig around it, after I fertilize it, after that, verse 9, after that, he said, sir, if there's no fruit, when you come back after a year, we'll whack it down. We'll whack it down. We'll cut it down. We got another year coming up. Will there be any fruit in our lives? Will there be any fruit in our church? Are we willing to be faithful and serve God? Not because the preacher asked you, not because you just thought, well, some of the other members might not like it if I don't. No, you do it to glorify God. Would you do it to glorify Jesus? Would you make 1988 count as no other year has really counted in your service for God? Would you do that? Lord willing, tonight I'm going to bring a message to encourage you along that line. I'd like for you to be here. I'd like for you to get it. 1988 could be a year that many things could happen. The Lord could come. We could go out to meet God. Many things could happen. Terrible things in the earth. Plagues. Look at this terrible plague of AIDS in the land today. That's here because of the curse God sent upon the sins of the people, the homosexuals and sex perverse and whatnot. And that's a curse. And they're not finding any cure for it. That thing could sweep this country. can wipe out half the human race as far as that. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm not a pessimist. I'm trying to tell you what might could happen. Our leaders are disturbed about it. They don't know. They don't know what might happen. And a lot of things could happen in the coming year. Make up your mind today that you have been planted in God's vineyard. God planted you there. You're going to produce the fruit. That's what God wants. You produce the fruit. How you do it, preach it, glorify God. And you know how to glorify God. You know what you ought to do and what you shouldn't do. Glorify God. You glorify God, and that take care of everything. Let's stand our feet. Precious Heavenly Father, we know there were 3 disappointed years for the owner to check this fig tree. Lord God, we know Jesus came to Israel, and for 3 years, he found no fruit. And then he gave them another year wherein the apostles and disciples preached, but no fruit from Israel. And then he cut it down. God help us.